So yes guys, let's get into the next topic of consolidation, that is chain holdings. Now what is this chain holding in the sense? Chain holding, we have two types of chain holdings. The first type of chain holding, always chain holding deals with indirect subsidiaries. How do we get indirect subsidiaries? Holding company holds more than 50% of the first subsidiary. Both combined, holding and subsidiary, hold in S2 greater than 50%. It can be 30-30 or 40-30, whatever it is, on a combined basis, both holding as well as the first subsidiary should contribute to more than 50% of the voting power in second subsidiary. This is one type of chain holding. The second type of chain holding, holding holds in second subsidiary, first subsidiary S1. This one holds in the second subsidiary S2. Greater than 50% H holds in S1. S1 holds more than 50% in H2. This S2 in both the cases, we will call this as indirect subsidiary. Now, what is the specific adjustment that we have to consider when we are solving problems in both the cases? Now, be it any case, remember the first logic always. Analyze and distribute the reserves of indirect subsidiary. S2 here. Always, whenever I have a chain holding, never start with S1 reserves. Always start with only S2 reserves. Be it analysis or the distribution of the reserves, both I have to start only with the S2 part. That is the indirect subsidiary part. Now, when I distribute for S2, if I am talking about the first situation, when I am talking about the case 1 of indirect subsidiary, when you distribute, the S2 reserves will have 3 parts. Normally we saw reserve has 2 parts, holding, minority. But in the first case, I'll have 3 parts. To the extent it belongs to holding H1, H. To the extent it belongs to S1. And to the extent it belongs to minority. 3 parts of S2 reserves will get. When you distribute the reserve, I have to distribute to the extent of holding company's reserve, to the extent of subsidiary S1 reserve, and to the extent of minority share of it. Now, after we solve till here, in the case 1, some check for case 2. Case 2, I will not have this 2. Case 2, when I do this distribution of S2, I do not have holding company's direct share in S2. So when I distribute, I'll only get 2 parts. A portion held by subsidiary 1 and a portion held by minority. Now, whenever I distributed this way, the reserves, my second step will come when you distribute distribution of reserves of the first subsidiary or the direct subsidiary S1. The first adjustment lies here. Now, what is the adjustment with regard to chain holdings when we distribute the reserves of S1? In the distribution table, when you record, my distribution table looks something like this. Pre-acquisition reserves and post-acquisition reserves. All all the reserves of S1 we have to distribute it or allocate it between pre-acquisition and post-acquisition relating to or with respect to the date of acquisition. Along with that, before we start distributing, we need to add one more thing. S1 share in post-acquisition reserves of S2. When S2 reserves are distributed, S2 also will have a pre-acquisition reserve and a post-acquisition reserve. The post-acquisition, when you distribute between holding S1 and minority or directly S1 and minority, you get S1 share in post-acquisition reserves of S2. To that extent, only to the extent of post-acquisition reserves, I need to distribute along with your S1. So we need to add it to the S1 reserves and then distribute. Now a question arises, why only post-acquisition? There's also pre-acquisition reserves, no? Remember, whenever we talk about pre-acquisition reserves, S1's share in pre-acquisition reserve will be considered in cost of control. It will be considered in cost of control. Because S1 has shares in S2. That means S1 and S2 also will have a cost of investment. Such cost of investment, when we are calculating goodwill or capital reserve, we need to consider this pre-acquisition reserve share of S1 in S2 there. Now, very good. You are talking about S1 share in the post-acquisition reserves of S2. Then what about holding company share in the post-acquisition reserve of S2? You will have in case 1 that. Case 2 will not get a holding company share in post-acquisition reserve of S2. You will not get it here. But in the case 1, I will have a situation where holding company has a share in the pre-acquisition reserve of S2 as well as post-acquisition reserve of S2. Those situations, H Limited share in post-acquisition reserves of S2 will be added to reserves for CBS. Reserves for CBS, holding company share in post-acquisition reserves of subsidiary. Subsidiary can be S1 or S2. Both will be added to reserves of subsidiary or the reserves of CBS in your step 7. This will be considered in step 5. Minority interest shares always added to minority interest. Got it? Record it till here. We'll see an illustrated example for this. Yes, guys. If you observe the distribution table, always we said first distribute S2. So when I distribute for S2, I have a pre-acquisition reserve and a post-acquisition reserve call. Let's say I am taking the case 1 into picture. When I take the case 1 into picture, S2 is held by holding subsidiary as well as S1 as well as minority interest. So my reserves will be distributed between holding, subsidiary S1 and also to the minority. Now every item or every amount in the distribution table should be used somewhere or the other. Where do I use this? Your holding company share in the pre-acquisition reserve of S2 will use it in cost of control step 5. Holding company share in the post-acquisition reserves will use it in reserves for CBS. Step 7. S1 share in pre-acquisition reserves, again cost of control, step 5. S1 share in post-acquisition reserve, this I will use in distribution of reserves. We have seen this. Distribution of reserves, we'll use it for S1's reserve, this is step 4. Minority interest, minority share, always in minority interest as per step 6. Similar for case 2 also we have the same thing, but we'll have only S1 and minority interest. So basically whenever we are talking about a distribution table, every item in the distribution table should be utilized this way. So this is the main part, or this will keep us understanding where each amount of a reserve of a subsidiary is going about. Because when we adopt the entire financial statements on a consolidated basis, we are not adding the reserve of subsidiary anywhere directly as we add the net asset. Asset, what do we do? 100 rupees of asset in the subsidiary, 100 rupees of asset in holding. We say consolidated asset is 200. But I'm not doing the same with the reserve. So where is the amount of each reserve going about? We need to look at this. Got it? So this is how we have to distribute. Yes guys, let's take some figures and let's try to identify how these figures go on. We'll take the first case, probably the most complicated part of it. Second one doesn't look so complicated. So, I need to give you three balance sheets. One for the holding company, H. Let's say equity share capital. Let's take simple figures. Holding company 100. Reserves and surplus was 60. Other liabilities being 120. On my asset side, I have some assets and I have investments. Investment in S1 and investment in S2. Let's say investment in S1 cost 140, S2 cost 60, so this is 200 and the balance should be 180. This is holding company's balance sheet. Let's come to S1 balance sheet. S1 also has investments in S2, do not forget this. Equity share capital, let's keep it as 100 only. Reserves and surplus, you can take it as 120. Other liabilities can be taken as 140. Take the assets as 200 or here it is 250 and my investment in S2. My S2's investment is 110. I'll make this as 280 and this 2. How much will this be? 80, no? Let us take S3 now. Sorry, S2 now. Equity share capital is 100. Assume that the reserves and surplus were 80. My other liabilities are 20. There is nothing else for him. Assets are 200. S2 does not hold investments in any company. So directly assets. Let us say my date of acquisition, whatever it was at the beginning of the year, my date of acquisition and my reserves and surplus on the date of acquisition in S1. S1 120 was there. On the date of acquisition, let's take it as 80. S2 on the date of acquisition, let's put just 90. Already we have an 80 figure. Let's not get confused. In S2, it was 80. Let's say it was 45 on the date of acquisition. Let us say for this entire holding, H holds in S1 60%. S1 holds in S2 40%. And H holds in S2 30%. Total again back to 70. I have holding company interest in the subsidiary S2. Let's say I have a situation this way and this was the reserves on the date of acquisition. I don't have to do any analysis of reserves, unnecessary, because I took straightforward. These are the pre-acquisition reserves. Balance should be post-acquisition reserves. Let's start directly with the distribution of reserves. I told you, always first distribute for indirect subsidiary S2. Maintain two columns, pre-acquisition and post-acquisition. Now check for S2. S2 on the date of acquisition, the reserve was 45. So my reserves and surplus, 45 is pre. What is the total reserve? 80. That means 35 is post. And what is the shareholding? First one, held by holding, held by S1, as well as held by minority. Shareholding percentages is 30, 40. Obviously, minority should be 30 again. Get it now. 30%. 30% is 4.5 into 3, 13.5. Into 4, 4.5 into 4 is 18. And again 13.5. 3, this is 10.5. This is 14 and again 10.5. If I start the analysis of S1 now, reserves and surplus of S1. What is the pre and post? Pre is 90, total reserve is 120, so post is 30. I can't distribute directly. Now comes the first adjustment here. S1's share in post acquisition reserves of S2. Nothing under pre acquisition column, but post acquisition column I need to consider this 14. 90 and 44, and now distributed between holding and minority interest, because S1 is only held by holding and the remaining people are called as minority. Holding company holds 60%, minority should hold obviously 40%. So 60-40, 54 and 36. And here it will be, how much? 26.4 and 16.6, 17.6. This is the distribution of reserves. Now let's go for cost of control. How many cost of control should we calculate? 3. H in S2. S1 and S2. H in S1. I have 3 links now. H in S1. H in S2. And finally S1 and S2. Start first. Always start with cost of investments. This cost of investment should be considered with share in net assets. My share in net assets is represented as share in share capital plus pre-acquisition reserves. Now let's check. Cost of investment, let's pick up H in S1, 140. H in S2, 60. S1 in S2, 80. Now share in net assets. Check. First, H in S1. H holds in S1 60% of the share capital. 60% of 100 is 60. H holds in S2 30%. 30% of 100, 30. S1 holds in S2 40%. 40% of 100, 40. Pre-acquisition reserves, careful. H in S1, 54. H in S2, 13.5. S1 and S2, 18. This will be 114, this will be 43.5, and this one will be 58. All the cases I get a goodwill. First case 26, second case 16.5, and the last case is 22. Three goodwills we get. Whenever I have a combination, we can combine all the goodwills. The combined goodwill will be 4264.5. Then come to your minority interest. How many minority interests we have now? Minority interest, I'll have 2. S1 minority interest and S2 minority interest. Minority interest always start with his share capital and his share of reserves. His share of reserves are split between pre-acquisition reserves and post-acquisition reserves. Check now. Both the cases, minority interest is 40%. So 40% of 100 rupees is 40. S1, H holds 60. So minority holds 40. S2, H holds 30. S1 holds 40. Okay. S2, it is 30, guys. Sorry about this. Yeah. S2, it is 30. Now come to the reserves. Reserves of S1. S1 reserves are 36, 17.6. S2's reserves are 13.5 and 10.5. 13.5 and 10.5, this is 24 plus 30, 54. And this one is 70, 80, 93.6. This total will be 147.6. That is the total of your minority interest. The last working note we need is reserves for CBS. Check your reserves for CBS. Always only one column, only the post acquisition column. So first always start with H Limited's balance. What is the H Limited's balance of reserves? Check the balance sheet. H Limited reserve, we consider it as 160. What is left out in the distribution table? I've utilized this. Even this. I'm left out with only the post H Limited share in the post acquisition reserve of S2. Similar way, everything being utilized, only one figure left out, holding company share in the reserves of S1. So, share in post-acquisition reserves. Share in post-acquisition reserves of S1 and S2. In S1, his share is 26.4. And in S2, his share is 10.5. Total is 196.9. Now check your consolidated balance sheet once. CBS consolidated balance sheet of H. Equity share capital as it is. How much is it? 100. Reserves and surplus. Pick it from reserves for CBS. 196.9. Minority interest. 147.6. Then I have some other liabilities. Other liabilities. Full consolidation. Simply add 120, 140, 260. 260 plus 20 is 280. Come to the assets now. 180, 280, 460, 200, 660. And finally, I'll have a value of goodwill, which is 64.5. And your balance sheet to total to 724.5. Check your liability side, it should tally. A simple way how to solve your chain holding problems. So first, my logic is, yeah, the figures are very small, they're easy to calculate. But understand the logic where each amount is going, where each amount is being allocated from the distribution table. This, if you can understand where each amount goes, then the remaining problem cannot be wrong. You will be definitely right in the remaining set of the problem. So this is where you have the crux of the entire thing. So where each amount is going, you need to properly allocate. Take down this, guys.